I have to admit that I've been spending a little too much time on Facebook lately. And what really gets me, aside from the barrage of political articles that my friends are always posting, are the how-to videos that people post. My favorite one of late is it may have been up for a while, but I discovered only the last couple months, the one that shows a myriad of incredible uses for those big black binder clips that so many of us have in our desks at work. The video shows how to use those binder clips to keep computer cords organized, or to prop up an iPhone so you can watch it without holding it, or to keep your toothpaste at the top of your toothpaste tube, and many, many others. It's like an 8-minute thing. What I love about this little video, besides the fact that it makes me feel like life organization is a reachable goal, is that it hammers home the idea that just as beauty is in the eye of the beholder, purpose is in the hand of the user. That is, the tools in our hands become useful or not, depending on our level of creativity. These little office supplies are just a couple of pieces of metal in plastic, and someone has thought of a way for them to truly serve very modern uses all the time. This idea is actually one that's present in this week's Torah portion that Sam is going to share with us in just a few moments. Although, like most things in the Torah, it takes on a moral and ethical bent. Last week's reading included the famous episode of the golden calf, in which the Israelites became so frenzied when Moses didn't return from Mount Sinai in a timely way that they felt they needed to build this idol to replace him and also to pray to and protect them in his absence. And they did this by taking gold and other materials and melting it down so that they would have a god to look at in their midst. This is, of course, as we know from having read this story, from whatever religious perspective we read it, this is a terrible choice for the people to lose faith in God the way that they do and to do the exact thing that they were told not to do, to build an idol. And they're punished when Moses does finally return, when he smashes the tablets of the Ten Commandments in his anger. But this week, the focus is on another building project, the building of the Mishkan, the tabernacle, this beautiful dwelling place for holiness, for God's Spirit, for the new set of Ten Commandments. And what we learn is that also for this building project, the materials of gold and fire and other things are used. But of course, this time, they're used to build not an idol that will distract people from God's presence and God's teachings, but rather to build a tabernacle, a mishkan, it's called in Hebrew, that will preserve God's teachings and remind people of God's presence. Our Jewish commentaries are quick to point out that the same raw materials, the gold and the fire, are used both to build the golden calf and to build the Mishkan, the tabernacle. And they connect these two incidents in their commentaries. This week's building project is a way of doing teshuvah, of repenting for last week's misstep. The Mishkan construction is a way of making amends for the golden calf project, our commentaries say. And there is another implicit lesson in the use of these same materials to build two very different things. And this one applies not only to the Israelites in the wilderness a long time ago, but to each of us sitting in this sanctuary today and to every human being we know and we see around us. Raw materials are, for the most part, completely neutral. It is what we do with them that determines who we are and the value of the lives we lead. It is not, for example, how much money we have that indicates the quality of our character, but rather what we do with our money. Generosity is a quality that transcends socioeconomic categories. It is not, for example, how many people we happen to meet in our lives that indicates how loved we will be, but rather it's how we treat those people, how we serve those people, how we show respect for them. Another example, Abraham Lincoln, with no access to schooling, Booker T. Washington, born into slavery, Albert Einstein coping with dyslexia, Maya Angelou born into abuse and hardship, counterexamples, countless counterexamples of people born into privilege who squander such gifts. These individuals remind us that what we make of our opportunities, whatever they are, determines our worth. It is not our religion, for example, that determines how righteous we are. We know only too well in this moment in history what a weapon religion can be if it's used that way, if an individual chooses to turn it into one. Rather, it's how we immerse ourselves in the best teachings of our faiths and whether we use it to heal and lift up rather than to hurt and beat down. What we learn from the Torah is that creativity is the essence of God's character. What does God do that no other entity can do? Create the world. Let there be light. And the Torah teaches we are created in God's image. So too are we most godlike when we apply our creative powers to the raw materials in our lives and create something new and something beautiful, something useful, something that enhances the world around us. When we think of the fire and the gold of the golden calf and the Mishkan, or the raw materials of our own lives, office supplies or otherwise, we must remember that what we make with and of them determines our worth, our capacity to lead others, and our capacity to change lives. How we use our creativity to turn neutral raw materials, whether fire and gold, or keys on a piano, or an orange ball and a group of guys on a team, into sources of challenge and meaning and righteousness. That is our task as human beings in search of living up to God's image.